a pleasure to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
You know, to come and be able to worship Him. Because we serve a mighty God.
That's right.
A good God. Amen. You know, when I got the message about opening, and you, like I said once before, preacher always told me, preach what's big in you. Talk about what's big in you. And one of the things is how good God is. And how that he brings us along step by step. And he doesn't give up on us. That's what I love about it. I just want to share just a few thoughts about one of my favorite biblical characters, Mr. Moses. And the thing about Moses is that, you know, he you can break his life into really three trimesters. You know, he had one when he was born, and it was at the time Egyptian was trying to get rid of all the boy babies, you know. And you think about a mom, says, no, we ain't going to do that. Mom was the best ship builder around. Built this little ship. But you can tell how God was leading, even at that point. Out of all the places, no, there was crocodiles in the river and stuff. Why did that little basket go right to Pharaoh's daughter? Now, what was really the chances of that floating over there? You know, and Pharaoh's daughter was you know, cleaning herself at that time, giving her back at that time and saw it. And Marion followed it. You know, and it's just how God worked all those circumstances. Then the baby got sent back home. The mother got to raise Moses. And he got paid for it. You know? Do you see how God was working? And you know the story. We don't go through all of it. But you know how during that time you get to thinking that when Moses was home and the Egyptian was in bondage, you know mom had to be telling Moses a lot of things. And the reason you know that is because when he got of age and he saw one where they was smiting each other, I'm going to read this. One day after Moses was grown, it happened, and this is in Exodus 2. One day after Moses was grown, it happened that he went out to his brethren and looked at their burdens, and he saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of Moses' brothers. Now, why did he all say he saw that, and he wanted to do something about it? Where does that come from? You know, mom was telling him, you know, God's going to provide a deliverer. God's going to provide somewhere. You know, Moses, you are chosen. Your life, God has a plan for your life. Now, this is really the first mistake Moses made. Okay, so Moses sees this, and you know when you're a leader, when you feel like God has called you to do something, you want to do something. You know, you just can't set back. The problem was, I always say this when I preach, Moses looked this way, he looked that way, and when he saw no one, he killed the Egyptian and hit him in the sand. Well, the problem with that, Moses didn't look up. That's what he should have done. You know, he should have looked up and said, I don't think this is the best thing for me to do, be killing him. So what he did, you know, hit him in the sand, thought, oh, no, there's no way. Nobody didn't see me. Now, you can't even think about nobody seeing him, all other people around. But nobody seen him. And he went out the second day and saw two Hebrew men quarreling and fighting, said to the unjust aggressor, why are you striking your comrade? And the man said, who made you a prince and a judge over us? Do you intend to kill me as you killed the Egyptian? Then Moses was afraid and thought, surely this thing is known. I guarantee you it was known. Because God knew about it. So the only thing Moses could do, I said, man, I found out. You know, he took off. Now you think about it. When he came back and he grew up in Pharaoh's house, had all the luxury, you know, he was powerful. And now he goes out in the wilderness. And as he goes out in the wilderness, you know, I'm sure he's starting to think, man, this can't be God's plan for my life. This can't be. There can't be. But, you know, again, that leader, God did, he still put that leadership quality in him. And then when he came and he went through the, we know the story about Midian, he was out there and he ran into the prince of Midian's seven daughters, who's going to go by the well, and the shepherds came and ran him off. Guess who stood up? See, Moses stood up. You know, God didn't forsake. God will never forsake you. He puts that quality in you. He's already woven them. You know, and that's one thing we don't want to ever stop denying, but he stood up. Then eventually, you know, he ended up being on the backside of the desert for 40 years. Now, you can imagine the first year, where's God at? And he's not really, you know, I'm sure he's out there, but, you know, he's tending the flock. Man, then it's a decade. I don't hear what God's doing. Man, 10 years, then it's 20 years. Long time. 30 years. Oh man, God didn't give up on me now. 30 years. But let's look at this. We have a 40-year period. 40 years. Think about that. But just before Moses had the burning bush experience, just before, I want you to look, this is Exodus 2:23. However, for a long time, nearly 40 years, the king of Egypt died, and the Israelites were sighing and groaning because of the bondage. They kept crying, and they cried because of slavery, ascended to God. Their cry because of slavery, ascended to God. God's aware of it. And listen to what happened. This is where I'm going to get to. And God heard their sighing and groaning, and earnestly remembered his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and with Jacob. And God saw, that's where we're at, God saw what you're going through. And Israel took knowledge of them and concerned himself about them, knowing all, understanding, remembering all. And we know what happened to Moses. When God called him, he saw the burning bush, he turned aside, and God called him to go back. And the story goes, what I really like about it is, you know, when God called Moses, it wasn't no sticks. There's no going to confuse you. You know what he said? He said, Moses, Moses. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's no, maybe there's another Moses out there running around. But he said he called him. And that's what God's doing today. When I thought about this, I thought, God is calling us, okay, for sure. And he said, you know what? This is holy ground.
Yeah.
When God's there, it's holy ground.
Right.
And that's what we have to look at. When we spend time with God, it's holy ground. And the thing God is saying, that God knows your trial. And Moses said, God told Moses to go back and tell that Pharaoh, tell him let go. And isn't it interesting? Moses makes it up, well, who should I say sent me? Isn't it interesting? This is what I like to get to. Okay? He said, I am. Isn't that interesting? God said, tell him I am sent you. He didn't say I was or I used to be. He said, I am. And that's what God is telling you today. I am the I am God. Okay, I hear your cries. I understand what you're going through. What I want you to do is tell them I am.
Yeah.
You know, you're one of the child. One day this week I was thinking about just having a situation of work and different things, and God was just put in my heart. You know what, Tim? You're a child of the King.
Yeah.
You ought to act like a child of the King.
Yeah.
You have me. I got you covered. Right. God is on your side.
Yeah.
You know, people used to say my brother's bigger than your brother. Well, I tell you what, it is in this case, let me tell you. My God is bigger than your God. Because there's only one God. There's only one true and mighty God. And that's Jesus Christ. Think about that. That's the only way it is. That's the only way it is. Okay? Because when he delivers, God delivers. When he heals, God heals. You know, and sometimes we look at life and we think, well, I don't know. God seems to be working off slow. It ain't slow in his time. It always looks slow in our time. You know, if one day is 1,000 years, 1,000 years one day. I mean, you think about 1,000 years, that's probably not even 10 seconds in God's time.
Right.
We just think, but you know what? Just because you don't see him working doesn't mean he's not working. Moses felt the same way. 40 years, where's God? Where's God? Where's God? God said, I'm still here. That's where I'm at. And when Moses turned aside, he saw it. When Moses turned aside, sometimes folks, when God brings up, we got to turn aside and say, God's trying to tell me something over here. God's trying to do something. I need to take time and take a look at what God is trying to do in my life at this point. It might be a difficult, Moses didn't understand it. When God said, you go back and tell him, well, wait a minute, God. You know, I don't speak very well. You know, I don't do this. And God was getting a little frustrated because Moses thing I was just, you know what? When God asks you to do something, you don't need to do it, just do it. That's what I love about my butter hat. You know why? Because you listen to God. Tim, we ought to do this. You know what I found out? Just do it.
Yeah.
Okay? God already knows the outcome. Because it said, you know, as Samuel said in the book of Samuel, it says, obedience is greater sacrifice. When you obey God, what he's doing, he's not going to lead you wrong. He said, come follow me.
Yes.
If you come to follow God, he's walking in front of you. That's when we got to come to that realization. God is good. He knows where we're at. He won't forsake you. And just tell him, I am. That's who I'm listening to. I am. I am. That's what Jesus said when he was talking to the Pharisees before Abraham was. Jesus said the same thing. He said, I am. And that's what it's all about. We serve the I am God.
Amen.
Amen. Sunday school bus. I love Bertha. She didn't hardly talk much on the Sunday school bus. She's real quiet. She's always polite. But when it came to testimony time, she was the first one up. It's like somebody poked her or something. She jumped up out of seat, and she sang the same song every single Sunday. She was so quiet, she got up, she said, standing on that rock, that never give away. Stand every single Sunday, that was her song. Because that meant something to her in her life. That's who she was standing on that rock. So who would be the first to testify what God has done for her?
I just want to thank God for all the blessings that He pours over my family. Was Mother's Day last Sunday? Okay. Last Sunday, my mom got like a recognition at her church for Mother of the Year.
Amen.
She was really excited. You know, my sisters were there, my nephew, and they prepared this whole thing where they set up all these good things about her and all that, and she was so excited and feeling so blessed. So I just want to thank God for that. And then also continue prayer for my family overall. You know, the scripture says, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved, you and your
household. Amen.
Yeah.
And I believe that those in my family that are not walking with Him right now will come, because that's the promise that we have in the Bible. All we have to do is believe.
Amen.
So just continue prayer that they get the revelation from the Holy Spirit that will bring them closer to Him.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's awesome. God is about family.
Right.
God is about family. We was created in His image. And you know, so a young person asked me, was God lonely when He created us? You know, because He wanted family. So I don't know if He's lonely or not, but we look like Him. And He loves us.
Yes.
And you know, He loves us with the everlasting love. You know, and it's funny, at the end of your life, when my mom passed away, it's interesting, she never said, well, Tim, better check on how much money I got in the bank. You know, you better check on how's the house still be checked. She didn't mention that. You know what she wanted around her? Family. Because that's what mattered. She knew she was going to be going on to glory soon, but she wanted to see all of her kids. That's what she wanted to do. She wanted to tell them, I love you. I love you. That's what matters to people. You know, I don't care if you're worth $10 billion, $5 billion. It doesn't matter when it comes down to it. It's family. You want your family to do well. And we're going to also pray for the Amtrak wreck. My daughter used to live out there on the East Coast. You know, and I feel bad. Don't know all the details of what happened yet. Still, but the fact is, you know, you plan, those people plan on their family coming home that night. Mm-hmm. That's what you plan on. It's just what they plan on.
Right.
But they didn't make it home. So you never know when your last day on earth was going to be.
Yeah.
You don't. You assume, because we plan for tomorrow, but we don't know that. So it's best to tell your loved ones, I love you today.
Yeah.
You know, give them that hug you thought about, or call them. When God puts it on their heart, you know, I need to call so-and-so up and tell them I love them. Why does God do that? You know it's not safe, because He don't care about people.
Right?
He ain't going to tell you, well, why don't you call Brother Joe and tell him you love him? Well, Satan ain't going to do that. He don't care. You know, just forget about it. But to spend that time with family makes such a difference. Someone else. Yes.
Yeah, you know, I really like what you said about Moses. And I the other day I was thinking that the Lord told me, Myron, it's been 23, I check my bank account almost every day. And I'm planning a trip to Texas in late July. And I'm wanting to do it. Was living in my means the way I've been doing the last 3 years. And I look back at that 23 years of paying child support and everything, and now that's all paid, and I am free. And I'm like, I look over it, and the Lord says, you got extra.
Amen.
You got extra. Start saving, put it away, bless people. Don't have to check your account every 5 minutes, every day.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden I realized the reason that I'm doing that is because of fear, because those years that I had trouble paying rent, and I had trouble going to the grocery store with my sons, and then have to put things back because I couldn't afford them. And all of a sudden the Lord says, those days are gone.
Come
Amen.
On,
Myron, those days are gone.
Right. Yeah.
See, you are, this is a new beginning. This is all things. become new.
Amen.
So and then this morning I started thinking, wow, I haven't had a real vacation in 30 years.
Wow.
I mean, where I can go and I can see things and enjoy myself, and I'm just like, God, you are so awesome.
Yes, amen.
You are so awesome.
Amen.
You know, my rent's paid, my utilities are paid, my car payment's paid. He says, go see your brother. Your brother's been through cancer. He's retired from the military. He's had problems in his family. Go be with him.
Amen.
So, June 29th, I will be leaving.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
For Texas.
Amen. God's good. God's good. He brings us out. He brings us out.
Yes, in the back.
I just wanted to thank everybody for praying for me.
Yes.
Coming through my surgery and dealing with things in my life. And remind everybody that perfect love,
yes,
perfect love of Jesus, casts out fear.
Yes.
Amen.
And I had something illuminated this week watching somebody on TV, and it was talking about the fact that by his stripes we are healed.
That's right.
But it said, what that meant, if I didn't go through all the things,
right,
and looking up every single word, but it said, by his stripes, it meant by joining together with him,
amen,
we are healed.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes.
Because where he is, there can't be sickness.
That's right.
Amen.
And there can't be pain.
Amen.
Because in him is perfect peace.
Yes.
Amen.
And I just thank God for the peace that he will give us when we just turn our mind back to him and,
yeah,
say, Lord, this is going on in my life. Here you go.
Yeah.
You handle it. And he will.
Yes.
Amen.
Every time. I'm just praising him. He's wonderful.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Surprise God when he's the one that made us and he preacher, you know, because he can reach a lot of people at once, you know. God can take those things and turn them around and use them for good. And that's the way he does in our life, you know. Some circumstances that maybe didn't be good the first time, but, you know, the second time around, we're going to grow. That's what the children of Israel, we had a lady who used to teach the Pentateuch a lot, and she said, those people in the Old Testament weren't any different than we are. You know, we look at them, oh, how could they have done that? Well, we got to take a look at our lives, you know, because they had their doubts and understand. But, you know, the people, the best Christians that I've ever met, it's not that they had it all together and have all, but they knew who they believed.
Yeah.
Like Paul said, they knew, you know, to know him. They understood that maybe they'll mess up, but you know what? They know who to go to the whole time. They know who to cry out to. You know, God doesn't call perfect people. He calls imperfect people. Let the perfect one live in. That's the big difference. You know, he calls us to be forgiving, be kind and understanding, to have a heart like him. Like Jacob was described as a man after God's own heart. You know, and I always look at, did he have the heart of God, or was he a man that was constantly after God's heart, that he wanted to know all about God and wanted to be able to do what God had called him to do? He messed up, but he realized, you know what, I'm going to call on God. I'm going to pray to him. He's the one I need to go to. He's the one, when I get on my knees at night, I need to be thankful. Somebody said we ought to count our blessings more than we do our troubles.
Yeah.
You know, we ought to do that, because I'll tell you what, we're blessed a lot more than, you know, when all the troubles we have in our life. Because I tell you, things can always be a lot worse in a person's life. But think of the time when you didn't have food, now you have full cover.
Uh-huh.
Think of the time when we get paid on Friday and your gas was so empty, boy, you just run on fumes Thursday night, buddy. You wonder if he's going to make it home.
Yeah, yeah,
we all been there, bud. We all been to that place. But you know what? You know, God brought us good. One thing God does not want us to do is never forget where we come from. Never forget where he brought it from.
Yeah.
Never forget that. You remember before you was a Christian, somebody brought that up in my life and said, well, Timmy did this. You know what I tell them? I said, that was B.C. That was before Christ.
Yeah.
That's what that was. That was before Christ. Why don't you look at life after Christ? Let's take a look at that. Let's look at the change that came in my life. I said, I'm going to praise God. You know, you're not, you know, a good man, he might fall down, but he's going to rise up.
Yeah.
You know, when these kids, we had the little clown, you hit and bounce back up. That's what we ought to be as Christians. I'm going to bounce back up. Hey, I'm not going to be defeated, because I serve the one who can't be defeated. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Yes.
Well, we live, I've heard so many positive things, but we live in the day when the Lord said that if it were possible,
that's right,
the very elect would be deceived. So when we face things that seem like, Lord, where are you? Where are you? We're in, again, we go to the Word because it tells us where we are.
That's
we're
right.
In the day that if it were possible,
yeah,
we'd be deceived.
That's right.
But thank God, it is not possible.
Amen.
We're living in a time, too, when I look and I see what's going on and I think, Lord, you said that the tares had to grow up with the wheat and it would be separated at the harvest. I am believing with all my heart the next great event that's going to happen to the church is the harvest.
Yeah.
And I always thought the angel puts in his sickle that somehow the Lord was going to do the harvest. Well, he is, but he is going to use you and I are going to be the instruments of the harvest.
Yes. Yeah.
And that's when we're going to hear his voice, just like Moses did, and he's going to say, all right, now I'm giving you the marching orders, and don't worry, because I am going with you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then you'll see signs and wonders such as this world's never seen.
Yeah.
But in the meantime, the devil has come. I've waited 52 years, for a prophecy the Lord gave me to come to pass. And I'll be honest, as I sit here today, it seems as remote as it did the day I first heard it. But we know that with God, like that, in the blink of an eye, every situation can be turned around.
That's right.
And I live every day waiting to hear his voice.
Yeah.
Now, I could go out on my own.
Absolutely.
I could try to make that happen. But I think of, like, but just this little something that says, just wait. And of course, for a human being, the hardest thing in the world is patience.
That's
I've had lots of trials, and I've wondered why, but that's how we get patience.
That's right.
And every time when it looked like, Lord, where are you? He showed up.
Yeah,
that's right.
Always.
Yes, sir.
When Jane was diagnosed with cancer, I mean, I can't explain what that was like, because one day everything's fine, the next day they told her it was everywhere. Now, this is John Stoddard, which is probably one of the greatest cancer places in the country, but definitely in Iowa. And we just, you know, we were stunned, but where did we turn? We turned to Jesus.
Yeah, right.
We reminded him, you were the same yesterday, today, and forever. If you only healed 2,000 years ago and it stopped, then we're all living in a dream.
Right.
But you are the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Yes.
Therefore, what you did 2,000 years ago, we claim today.
Yes.
And we did not let go of that. We prayed, we cried, we fasted, we did everything. And I'm telling you what, he showed up in a magnificent way.
Yeah.
Not just for us, but for all those people that John started.
Yeah.
Amen.
They saw it and said, we can't explain it.
Amen.
Jane told him, she said, well, we believe in the healing God. He did it 2,000 years ago. We believe he does it today.
Amen.
Amen.
So,
amen.
He is the same yesterday.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Anyone else? Well, we'd like to stand up and pray. We're going to pray over these requests and just praise God for how good he is.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. Let's lift our hands up. Pray. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. We serve a mighty God. Hallelujah. A God, hallelujah, that says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. It's all about you, God. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we heard these praises, Lord. Hallelujah. You inhabit the praises. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, that we can call out to you. We can thank you, Father God. Lord, that you would be with James' friend, Ron. Hallelujah. That's with you now. And realize, hallelujah, that he's at peace now. Oh, Father God, let James comfort James at this time. Father God, in the name of Jesus, because it's hard to lose a friend. But we know one day we'll see that friend again. Oh, Father God, we thank you for Jane. We thank you how you touched her body and healed her in the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. We ask you to be Roberto and his family. Father God, we ask you to be with them because you realize, hallelujah, that Lord, hallelujah, that light can shine on through. We thank you for Roberto being that light to his family. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, be with Dean. Be with everybody in the sound of my voice today. And let everybody realize it's about you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, because this is holy ground. And we come to praise you today. We come to believe you today. We come to lift you up today. Father God, that you reign your Holy Spirit now, this place today. Father God, in the name of Jesus, that today our hearts will be changed. Today, how we will come to know you more and more. Hallelujah. Before this day is over, we'll be challenged for this day. up to you in your wonderful, wonderful, wonderful holy name.
Yes.
We pray. We pray. We exalt you, mighty God. Mighty God. Mighty God.
Yes, Lord.
Our Savior. Hallelujah. We pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
That's an awesome thing to be able to graduate. You know, that's an accomplishment. And we ought to encourage our kids that they got that far in school. We thank the Lord for that.
Amen.
Okay?
Amen.
All right. And
there we go.
Okay, and then Zach Price graduation ceremony is at today's ceremony, Sunday, May 17th at 2 o'clock, Sunday at high school. Receptions afterward, East 43rd Road and Hull Avenue. We're very proud of Zach. Again, to get that far from kindergarten all the way up, that's an accomplishment. And, you know, we want God to continue to use them. Wherever they decide to go to school at, that God can take that life that's in them and use them on college campus.
Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Hallelujah.
All right. Ready to speak the word.
Praise the Lord.
Okay. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you?
Hallelujah.
These signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick and they do recover. Amen. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. The eyes of mine understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, church. Let's worship and praise Him, for He alone is worthy. While we're waiting for Brother John to get back and get the clicker for the overhead slides, we're just going to praise and worship His holy name. I got a daughter, Jenny, my oldest daughter in North Carolina right now. She's
facing back pain and experiencing sciatic and stuff, and they're talking surgery and stuff like that. But I don't know if you all remember Kayla Nichols, who was here with Brettley. She's out of Bethel Church. And I asked them to pray over a prayer cloth to send to my daughter in North Carolina, and she was happy to do it. But I also told my daughter that we're going to pray for her too. And Myron's videoing right now, and I'm going to send her the DVD of today's service so she sees how this all works and stuff. And I gave her the scriptures to back it up. As we get to later on, there's a song, There's a River, that Suzanne's going to lead. I'm going to bring that prayer cloth out. Now, if you all want to stand with me and stuff, and we'll anoint this thing for my daughter, just claiming the healing for her back so she doesn't have to go under the knife of the financial situations and everything else she's facing down there right now, because our God is a healing God.
Yes.
And he will provide, he will heal, and bring this thing into completion. Hallelujah. In the meantime, we're going to praise him. Hallelujah, Lord. Glory to your name. Every voice in this place, sing hallelujah. Praise our God, seek his face, sing hallelujah. Every tribe, every tongue, sing hallelujah. Everything, everyone, sing hallelujah. For the Lord our God is a righteous King. Sing hallelujah. For the Lord our God is enthroned on high. Sing hallelujah. He has rescued us with his strong right hand. Sing hallelujah. Every voice in this place, sing hallelujah. Praise our God, seek his face, sing hallelujah. Everything, every tongue, sing hallelujah. Everything, everyone, for the Lord our God is a righteous King. Sing hallelujah. For the Lord our God is enthroned on high. Sing hallelujah. He has rescued us with his strong right hand. Sing hallelujah. He has filled our lives with his faithful love. Sing hallelujah. Young and old, rich and poor, sing hallelujah. High and low, exalt the Lord, sing hallelujah. For the Lord our God is a righteous King, sing hallelujah. For the Lord our God is a God on high, sing hallelujah. He has rescued us with his strong right hand. Sing hallelujah. He has filled our lives with his faithful love. Sing hallelujah. Bridge, bridge.
Keep playing, keep playing.
praise the Lord this day, church, right? The doctor's telling my wife she has heart condition, putting her on blood pressure medicine, and Jane's been battling through stuff like that. But you know what? They're going to just keep praising the Lord. We're going to dance our way into victory. That first slide you saw with Miriam, with the timbrel and the dance, Moses' sister, she just walked on through it. Yeah, I'm old, so what? I'm following the footsteps of the Ancient of Days, okay? I'm just going to keep our praise on. And church, I want you to keep your praise on no matter what you're facing. Jump on it. Let's go for it. It's time. We've been in the back seat too long. It's time to drive in the front seat. It's time to take the wheel that the Lord has handed to us. And we're going to worship Him. We're going to glorify Him. We're going to magnify Him. And take back the land that has been taken from us. The children and grandchildren that we have lost. That's it. They're coming home. They're coming home. Coming home. As we cling, glorified holy name. Hallelujah. Sing.
Bye. from the north, south, and west, his sons and his daughters, and calling them. Give them up, give them up, give them up.
Father is calling,
give them up. Lift up your voices and sing. We have a right to speak to this world. Give up your captives today. Give them up. Give them up. Give them up.
Father is calling.
Give them up. Give them up.
Angels gather round your throne and around. Done in this service. Thank you, Lord, that it is finished, Lord. Every obstacle, every situation, every circumstance that comes against us, that challenges us, Lord, we have the victory, Lord, and the victory is in you. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for making us more than conquerors, Lord, in every circumstance. Hallelujah, Jesus. You have lifted us up, Lord, seated with you in heavenly places, far above every principality, every power, every evil. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. By your stripes, we're healed. Thank you, Lord, that because you became poor, we become rich. Thank you, Lord. You became sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God in you. Thank you, Lord, for seeing us perfect in Christ, accepted in the beloved, above all, over all, in all and through all. In Christ, we are one with you, Lord. All things become one, and a river runs through it. Praise the Lord. Out of our bellies flow rivers of living water. Hallelujah. The Holy Spirit to minister, to touch lives, to open doors, and to overcome every situation. Thank you, Jesus. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise
Amen.
Lord.
Give the Lord a hand clap this morning. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Praise God. Thank you, worship team, as always. Thanks, Tim. Everybody for sharing your testimonies. Praise the Lord. We talked about that a little bit Wednesday night. And it's so important that we share with one another. It's part of worship. Amen. It's not just something we do to pass the time, but it really is about exalting the Lord and lifting Him up. Praise God. And when God is big, everything else shrinks. Praise the Lord. So we just need to, amen, see Him always victorious on the throne. Praise God. You know, y'all heard of Annie Southern. Sullivan, Annie Sullivan. She was the lady who taught Helen Keller. Helen Keller was blind, deaf, and unable to speak. Born that way, or at least from infancy, she was had that condition. And this Ann Sutherland came to teach, to try to teach her. She'd never had any communication with the outside world. Imagine this now. You can't see, you can't hear, and you can't speak. But your body works. She'd never seen her parents, never heard their voices, never been able to speak to them. And so, after days and weeks and months and literally years, she was trying to teach Helen Keller how to communicate with a world that she really didn't have any clue about. And it came that, if you ever saw the movie or read the book, it actually, the breakthrough happens at a pump. She's pumping water, and she's been signing on her hand making words that trying to get her to associate with, and she just didn't get it, you know, until finally she pumping water on her hand and she signed for water. And it just like popped. All of a sudden, Helen figured out what all this was about, and she realized that she could communicate, and she started signing then different things. And years later, Annie Sutherland tried to teach her the concept of God. And finally, she signed on her hand. Praise the Lord. G-O-D. And Helen Keller said, I always knew him. I just didn't know his name. God has put eternity in the hearts of men. Somebody just has to give them the name, give them a way of associating, connecting. As tragic as Helen Keller's situation was, the truth is she's better off than a lot of people that see, hear, and speak. She knew God before she even knew what to call him. God is reaching for everybody. And it's our responsibility not to necessarily preach to them or put tracts in their hands. And there's really nothing wrong with that. I mean, I've done all that, but the truth is, when we live our lives focused on Jesus, which is what's been said here this morning, it's not about us going out and grabbing people on the street and shaking them and telling them, come on, believe. It's like Tim said, somebody just invited him to church one day. The truth is, God has put people in our paths, in our lives, through circumstances, and all we really need to do is live our life with an attitude that Jesus can provide everything and anything. And by doing that, we are the greatest witness that we can ever be. We make God real simply by living it and believing it ourselves. And that's what people need. That's what all they really need. They don't need a lot of religious trappings. They just need to know that he is and that he cares about them, that he loves them. Praise the Lord. So, now that I've got my crime jag over with, hallelujah. I wasn't expecting that. Praise the Lord. It just happened. Praise God. Romans chapter 6, and we'll begin reading verse 4. Romans 6 and verse 4. Praise the Lord. God is good. Just like Tim was saying, there's nothing more true or real than the goodness of God. Amen. So therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Drop down to verse 6, please. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. Now, if you will go to verses 10 and 11. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen? Amen. All right, Galatians chapter 2, verses 19 and 20. For I, through the law, am dead to the law, that I might live unto God. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Praise the Lord. One more, Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 6. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Thank the Lord. Amen. So, you know, we think that we're the problem, when counterintuitively, we are now actually part of the solution. That's one of the negative things about religion, is it makes you feel like you're the problem, when in fact, God is saying, I've made you the solution. Amen. Or at least part of it, along with Him and in Him. Amen? Amen. See, God doesn't want to replace us. He already did it. He did that with a new self, a new creation. We are His spiritual offspring. As more real, really, than we are even fleshly offspring of our own natural parents. It's more real because it's eternal. It's God's truth. Amen? John chapter 3 and verse 6. We got quite a few scriptures here this morning, so just hang in here. Praise the Lord.
Which verse?
John chapter 3, verse 6. I want you to see this by the word of God. Amen. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the spirit is spirit. Mm-hmm. Yes. All right. Romans chapter 6, verse 13. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Okay. 1 Corinthians 6, 17. But he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. So again, God doesn't want to replace us. God wants to embrace us. Yes. Praise the Lord. We want to be like Jesus. And so we try to behave like Jesus, or like we think Jesus would behave. And we might hope that, you know, little by little, almost by osmosis or something, our nature changes a little day by day and over the years, right? But the truth is that the deep down inside of us, we are already exactly like Jesus. The part of us that really matters, the part of us that's going to be forever, is already just like Jesus. Amen? 1 John chapter 4, verse 17. Now, a lot of times it sounds like when we're saying these things that we're just like kind of on an ego trip or just being, you know, oblivious. But this is what the Word of God says. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. How? Because as He is, so are we in this world. So when the day of judgment comes, I'm tired of hearing about Christians being judged. Praise the Lord. We are rewarded.
Come on.
We've already been judged in Christ. There can't be another judgment for us. It would be like double indemnity or something. It would be like a, you know, being charged twice for the same crime that's already been punished.
Right.
Love has made us perfect, that we may have boldness, that we can come on the day of judgment. We aren't going to be afraid, church.
Right.
You maybe have a little anxiety about it today, but I want to relieve that. I want you to know that on the day that God judges, we have boldness to come and not come slinking up or, you know, kind of backing into the room or hoping He doesn't recognize us somehow. We'll come boldly in knowing, amen, that we have already been judged in Christ. Because as Jesus is, how many of you believe Jesus is perfect?
Amen.
Amen. As He is, so are we here and now in this world. So deep down inside of me, I'm not talking about what I see in the mirror and my natural actions from time to time. I'm talking about who I really am is as good as He's ever going to get, as close to God as I can get. Everything is perfect with me and the Lord.
Come on.
It's true of you.
Amen.
It can't be anything other than that. If God sees, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased, and He tells me that I am exactly perfectly like Him, then God's got to have the same attitude about me.
Come on, man.
He's got to have the same attitude about you.
Come on.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. See, there's a big difference between wanting to be like Jesus and realizing that because of a radical spiritual transformation, you are like Jesus. Let me say it again. There's a big difference between us wanting to be like Jesus and realizing that because of this transformation that God has done, this radical work of the Holy Spirit through Christ, we are exactly like Jesus. Somebody ought to say praise the Lord. I'm telling you, that's the good news, man. I mean, that is the good news. We are accepted in the beloved. God loves us. God's not holding anything against us. God is not judging us. He's blessing us, praise the Lord, because of Jesus. Because Jesus became sin so that we can be the righteousness of God in Christ. See, the one view, the view that I want to be like Jesus, right? It is always promoting, urging effort on my part.
Right.
Works. Mm-hmm. Right? Stuff I got to do.
Right.
The other promotes relaxation. Rest. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Praise the Lord. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. Who the Son sets free ought to be free. Ought to be free indeed. Amen. Not just trading one set of bondages for another, but free.
Hallelujah.
Hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. God cannot dwell in an unholy vessel. God would not come to any place that hasn't already been sanctified, made holy, and pure. And we have it, Christ in us, the hope of glory. Jesus would not be in you if you weren't already made perfect.
Thank you, Lord.
A perfect place for him to dwell.
Amen.
The Holy of Holies.
Yes.
Amen. Titus chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior.
Yes.
So, let's do this question. So what if we really are like him? What if, according to his word, we have his spirit? What if we have his nature? What if we have his mind? 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 16. For who hath known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. We have the mind of Christ. What if he changed us, changed our spirit, changed our heart, so that now we fit with him? Amen? So we're not oppositions, but like a magnet, we fit. We fit together.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Look at Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26 and 27. Chapter 36, verses 26 and 27. A new heart also will I give you, a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I'll give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them.
Hallelujah.
All right, now look at 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17. This is what God said he did now. This is the prophecy. We know that this is what takes place in the new birth. But he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. One spirit with God Almighty, who is a spirit. But when we're joined to the Lord, when we get born again, we are one spirit. Praise the Lord. I'd say that makes you a pretty good spirit, right? That makes your spirit good. Praise the Lord. Joined to the Lord. One spirit. Amen?
Amen, Lord.
Let me ask you a question. Who told you there was something wrong with you? Besides the church, I mean. Praise the Lord. Amen? You know, God asked Adam, who told you you were naked? Right? Because he knew Adam didn't know he was naked until somebody told him. Mm-hmm. See, thousands of years after that, we're still scared. We're still ashamed. We're still covering ourselves with the leaves of self-improvement. Let me just admonish you this morning. Stop trying to get close. Stop trying to stay close. Relax. Rest. Practice. I know this sounds crazy, but practice doing nothing. How about this? Nothing to get more forgiveness. Nothing for more acceptance. Nothing to get closer. I'm not saying don't read your Bible. I'm not saying don't pray. But listen to what I'm saying. I'm saying none of those things are going to advance or improve God's view of you. It's helpful. It'll help you understand more about God. But it isn't going to get you any closer to God. It isn't going to make you any more accepted by God. It isn't going to make God love you any more than he already does. There's nothing you can do to be more dead. All right? I mean, dead is dead. We read all this, not all of them, but we read several of the scriptures. There's nothing you can do to be more dead. Therefore, there's nothing you can do then to be more alive.
Come on.
You are alive in Christ. You are dead to your sins.
Yes.
You are alive to God. You can't make yourself more alive to God. You're one spirit with him. Praise God. Hallelujah. Look at Romans chapter 6, verses 10 and 11. For in that he died unto sin once. But in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon ye yourselves also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. It can't be any simpler than his own words, right? Look at, let's look at 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 31. So he's saying here, to die to yourself is to rid yourself of yourself. Because you're dead.
Amen.
You can't be more dead. Amen?
Amen?
Spiritual death with Christ is not a progressive thing.
Right.
It's once for all.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? You're not gradually becoming more dead.
Right. Yeah.
You died. You were crucified. You were buried with Christ. It is finished.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I protest by your rejoicing which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord, I die daily. Now, the church has made us believe that that means we're killing ourselves a little bit every day. That's not what he's talking about based on all the other scriptures. When you bring it in context, he can't be saying that. You're already dead. So what is he saying? Amen? Look at Luke chapter 9 and verse 23. He said to them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. Mm-hmm. We are supposed to wake up every day and count ourselves dead to sin and alive to God.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. You know, we're not supposed to wake up every day and start trying to kill, or, you know, commit some kind of suicide. We're supposed to wake up every day saying, I'm dead. That thing that was, you know, going to be judged, that person, that flesh that was failing and flawed is dead. And I'm alive to God. Because I was once dead to God. I was once cut off from God. But no longer now, he and I are one. Now we're one spirit. I'm dead. But yet I live. Yet it's not me that lives, but it's Christ living in me. I've become one with God. Amen. What God is telling us is, every day, consider yourselves new in Jesus Christ. Every day is a new day. Every day you wake up brand new. Every day, no past. Right? It's a brand new day. And you're perfect. And tomorrow, it'll be another day just like it. Even if you fail today, tomorrow you'll wake up a new creature again. Amen. It's like Groundhog's Day, only with good instead of negative. Every day is a new day, and every day is a perfect day. Because you are one with God. And anything and everything about you that could be judged is dead. It doesn't exist. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 and 17. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. Now flesh, what we need to understand is flesh is equivalent to a way of human effort. Flesh is human strategies. Right?
Right.
Look at Galatians chapter 3. And verse 3. It's the only way you can look at these scriptures in the context of what Jesus has said about us. Are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit? Are you now made perfect in the flesh? Now, what was it they were doing that they thought was going to perfect them more than what they had already been perfected by the Spirit? There had to have been religious stuff that they were doing. There were good things they were doing. It wasn't that they were doing evil stuff and thinking that it was going to get them some kind of hickeys with God. They were doing good things. But Paul's saying, look, you're missing the point here. You were made perfect through his death. You were raised with him and seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You are perfect. What you're doing here is flesh. Flesh can become the object of our confidence.
Right.
Hey, I can tell you, I've got some history here. It's what you do that's going to give you blessings from God, that's going to give you power with God. And it's absolutely untrue.
Right.
That is flesh.
Uh-huh.
He identifies it this way.
Right.
Philippians chapter 3 and verse 4. Though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinketh that he hath it whereof, he might trust in the flesh, I more. This is Paul speaking, because he was a very religious, devout Jew, right? But here's the problem. Flesh is not your old self. Your old self was crucified.
Yeah.
It's dead. Uh-huh. It ain't lingering. It isn't hanging around. It isn't part dead. It isn't kind of dead. It is dead based on the Word of God. Your flesh, hallelujah, is dead.
Come on.
It's been crucified. Flesh is just residue. Let me say it this way. Your old self, your nature, is dead.
Mm-hmm.
But the flesh is residue.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I mean, we've read it. You were crucified. So who you were, your old self, is dead, period. And a new creation has come as a result of that.
Mm-hmm.
because of the resurrection.
Right.
Your flesh is not your old self. Mm-hmm. Your old self is dead. Right. Your flesh is just residue. It's the leftover in the way that you think and the way that you approach life.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. Amen? Amen? The flesh, then, is a way to think or a way to act.
Right.
Habits, strategies. This will work. I know how I can do this. This is what Don was talking about. How many haven't all of us? We know we got promises from God. And like Moses, it's been a while since the promise. And we haven't seen the fulfillment of it. Mm-hmm. Right?
Right?
We have strategies. They work for us in some ways. Right? And they're not necessarily bad. It's just they're not what God wants. They're not by the Spirit. They're still flesh. They'll still produce only what the flesh can produce. That's what the flesh is. The flesh is a way of thinking. Flesh is a way of strategizing to make things happen, to make things work out. Amen? But the flesh is not us. But still, based on what we hear in religion, what we're basically taught is that you might think that you should get out there and hand out tracts and knock on doors and do your best to be radical and change the world. I know. I'm saying God, that's what we think. But God has placed us strategically by the Spirit in the families that we're in the relationships that we have, on the jobs that we have, in the communities that we live in the apartments, in the houses, in the wherever it is we are. God, we think, well, you know, I rented this, I bought this, I went here, I went. No, God is directing our steps. Do you not think God knew Moses was on the backside of the desert? Yes, he put him there. He led him there. He had a plan, but the plan had to be based on the Spirit, not on the flesh.
Right.
What Moses did wasn't necessarily an evil thing. I mean, I don't believe in killing people. But under the circumstances, he was sticking up for what he felt was right with God.
Mm-hmm.
He's protecting God's people.
Right.
Nobody else was there to do it.
Right.
But what did it do? It didn't bring about the promise that God had given him. It didn't make him a deliverer at that moment. It made him a coward.
Right.
It caused him to flee. Amen? To not trust God for the promise. 40 years, God's training him. I'm still God.
Mm-hmm.
My plan's still the same.
Mm-hmm.
I can still do it. Right?
Right.
We think 70 years, 75, woo. Getting close, Lord. I don't know. Right? We might even think at 40, if it hasn't happened. I mean, what's the chances, you know? He waited till Abraham was completely dead to his flesh.
Uh-huh.
Right? And then he does a miracle. Mm-hmm. The promise that he'd given him years and years before.
Mm-hmm.
Because now it's God. It's the Spirit that moved.
Mm-hmm.
And not intellect. Not a strategy. They had a strategy, right? They had a... Hey, this ought to work. I know I'm still capable of fathering a child, but my wife isn't capable of giving birth. So, it's legal. They belong to me. That's my property. I can have a child with her, and we'll take it and raise it as though it were ours. We look at it and go, oh, God, that's just hideous. No, that was normal. That was normal in those days. But it didn't work.
Nope.
Even though the intentions were good.
Yeah.
The strategy seemed to make sense. It wasn't by the Spirit of God. Amen? So all of our bell ringing and door slamming and banging and handing out and screaming at people and, you know, you're going to bust hell wide open and all these other things, they are simply a way of exciting the religious flesh.
Yeah.
It's still flesh.
Yeah. Yeah.
We stir up religious flesh. which is what Paul was talking about in Galatians 3:3. Who's deceived you? What's happened? Having begun in the Spirit, you got born again by the Spirit without any effort on your part, in spite of what you might have been told. Amen? It happened in a split second when you just simply identified with Christ, accepted what He's done, the finished work of Christ. You may not even have perfect theology, but you, from the heart, believed. Now you think you're going to perfect that? That born-again, new creation experience? By just a lot of activity? Just a lot of hype? Rule-based, self-centered, self-focused flesh is no better than any other kind of flesh. Religious flesh is still flesh. Galatians 3:3 again. Let's look at that. Are you so foolish? Having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by the flesh? Hey, there's more flesh in most churches than there is at a strip club. Amen. I assume. Been in a lot of churches, haven't been to that many strip clubs lately. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. But they're there, you know, and I'm just saying, the flesh is still the flesh. Right. Praise God. All right, Colossians chapter 2, verses 20 through 23. Praise the name of the Lord. Wherefore, if ye be dead with Christ from the rudiments of the world, why, as though living in the world, are ye subject to ordinances? Touch not, taste not, handle not, which are all to perish with the using, after the commandments and doctrines of men. Which things have indeed a show of wisdom in will worship, and humility, and neglecting of the body, not in any honor to the satisfying of the flesh. Praise the Lord. When we go that route, we aren't trusting in the growth that comes from God. We're trusting in what we can produce with religious flesh. Amen? Look at Colossians 2:19. And not holding the head, from which all the body, by joints and bands, having nourishment, ministered and knit together, increaseth with the increase of God. When we don't focus on the head, when we are not using the mind of Christ, we're not operating by the Spirit, which is the way that the whole body is cohesed together, amen, we're not nourishing, we're not ministering, we're not bound together, and we don't increase with the increase of God. It's another way of saying you cannot produce fruit by the flesh, not spiritual fruit. You can't produce spiritual realities with natural behaviors.
That's right.
I think this is why these are the end times. Mm-hmm. This is the time when this harvest, this great harvest, is going to come. But as it was said, the angel, they're not harvesting. They can't save anybody.
Right.
They can't introduce anybody.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? They can. They protect us, they bless us, they watch over us, but we are the means, the tool by which God will create this harvest.
Yes.
We are the sickle.
Yes. Yes.
Well, we cannot, this is my opinion, we can't do this by the flesh.
That's right.
You can't have enough revivals and enough spiritual flesh to make this reality. This is something that only the Spirit of God can do.
Amen.
Therefore, we have got to stop focusing on our strategies for revival or for the end time. We got to start just focusing on God and allowing God to operate and use us the way only God can do it.
Come on.
Amen? Yeah. I'm saying we need to start doing nothing, amen, if we're going to expect any results. Somebody say praise the Lord. Amen. I know. I'm saying, I understand this is all counterintuitive because of everything we've ever been taught in the natural. You only pull yourself up by your bootstraps. The harder you work, the more you succeed. And the church has carried that same kind of attitude over into our religious endeavors. And so we do a lot of stuff, but very little of it is of God. Because we just think it's a good thing to do. It'll bring somebody in. You know, we'll give away more bicycles or we'll have more of this or more of that. And I'm not saying any of those things in and of themselves are bad. I'm just saying they don't produce anything from God.
Right.
They produce only what we can produce as humans.
Right.
God alone, by His Spirit, draws men.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Each and every one of us came to God one way. We were drawn by the Spirit. There's no other way to get to God except through Jesus Christ. And unless the Spirit draws them, no man comes.
Right.
We don't get any credit for that.
Right.
Why would we think that if that's how we got into this as the Galatians, that now somehow we're going to have great strategies that we're going to come up with and wisdom of thinking that we're going to make things happen? It ain't going to happen. It's going to happen by the Spirit, or otherwise we just get frustrated. And we've been frustrated for a long time because we've been trying to do too much good and not enough God. That's why it's critical, why what has been said here, what Tim was talking about, all of you. We need to hear God. We need to be obedient to the voice of God, not to a bunch of rules, but to when God speaks to me at the Walmart and says, talk to this guy. Like Dean said, when God spoke to him at the hospital, speak to this woman. That's because the Spirit is dealing with that person right then and right there, and that's when God's opportunity to really minister is there. Now, we could go around talking about Jesus all we want, and there's nothing wrong with that, but most of the time we know what it produces. Confrontation, aggravation, frustration, and humiliation. Right? Because it's not in sync with what the Spirit's doing. That person's hostile, they're aggravated, they're frustrated, they're whatever. They're not ready. But when the Spirit says, move, you can write it down. That person is going to be sensitive to what you're saying. What you're saying. You don't have to be a perfect theology student or teacher. You just got to be led by the Spirit.
Right.
You can say stuff that just doesn't make any sense to you at all, and they'll break down and start weeping. Has it ever happened to you before? You're just talking to somebody, and you're thinking, man, what got into them? You don't even realize the impact that you can have by the Spirit. It's the only real lasting impact you can have. And so I'm saying all these things that I'm saying here today, not to ridicule churches or religions, although I suppose it sounds like that, but I'm just saying we've got the cart in front of the horse. I mean, we're trying to do this thing backwards instead of allowing the Spirit, which is the only one that can really do what needs to be done.
Amen.
We are dead. Quit trying to resurrect some kind of spiritual flesh that is just that is just a residual way of thinking, a kind of a hangover, amen, from when you were alive to the flesh. Praise the Lord. Where am I? Praise the Lord. Colossians 2:20. Have I done that? This is 2:19, right? Not holding the head, from which all the body joints, bands, have nourishment and ministry and knit together, increaseth with the increase of God. So the try-harder religious flesh and the frustrated give and walk away from God flesh, which is what happens to a lot of people after they've been in the religious flesh, they're so frustrated because they can't keep living perfectly, that then they get this frustration and the give-up kind of flesh and just walk away from God, that flesh, they're both wrong. There's a third way. There's a better way. And it's called relaxing. It's called resting in the sufficiency of God. It's believing what we say, that I am is sufficient for whatever the situation, the circumstance. Right now, the I am is also another thing. It's now. God doesn't necessarily deal with us future tense. We know that He's already dealt with the past tense. But He's always now. So, as Tim was saying, He's outside of time. When we think God gives me a promise and it's now, I'm thinking now in a 24-hour time-space continuum. It ought to happen here, and it ought to happen now, or at least within a reasonable amount of time that I can measure. But I am as I am. We may age, our thoughts may change, our strategies may vary, but He doesn't. He knows you. He knows me. I'm forever young.
Come on.
Amen. I haven't aged a bit in eternity.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. But it's that mindset that makes us think in terms of the flesh. Again, it's not evil. It's just not productive.
Come on.
It makes us limit God. It makes us say, limit God to my potential, to my age, to my abilities.
Yep. Yeah.
I am. I am can do the same thing with you at 95 as He can do with you at 25.
Come on.
Maybe more, because there's a whole stage being set for this opportunity that God has called you to. I'm not just talking about Donnie. I'm talking about every one of us are in the same situations. But God is not just picking me out like in a vacuum and sticking me someplace and do this. No, He has divine spiritual strategies that are based on all kinds of lives, all kinds of situations and circumstances, and He's setting them up.
Yep.
And I think I'm going to come in with my limited pea brain, and I'm going to outthink God and set up something that's going to work better than what God's been designing throughout my entire life, actually from the womb, amen, of my mother, actually from before the foundation of the world.
Yeah.
And that's true for every one of us. There are divine setups, if you want to call them, or divine strategies that you are a part of. Your life is interwoven with other people and other situations and circumstances specifically for the spiritual productivity that God can produce through you if you operate by the Spirit and not by the flesh. Praise the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. And He said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. My grace is sufficient, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. He's talking about flesh. Right? The Spirit is perfected when the flesh is rested. The Spirit has the ability to produce anything and everything as long as my flesh isn't trying to do it at the same time.
Yeah. Right.
That's why Jesus said, you need to enter in to my rest. Let me do the work. Amen. You just trust me. You just focus on I am.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Okay, Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. We think that means jumping somebody from the opposite sex first chance you get. You know, or getting drunk, or you know, doing something else. No, He's talking about if you walk in the Spirit, if you're led by the Spirit, if you do what Paul was talking about earlier, and that is be weak in the flesh, His strength is made perfect. I'm walking in the Spirit as long as my flesh isn't trying to control it. If I'm busy doing this, handing this out, giving this talk, all this kind of stuff, I'm not walking in the Spirit. I'm operating by the flesh. How many of you know, if you're good at something, I don't care what it is, you don't pray about that, do you? I mean, if there's some things that just come, who have natural giftings for whatever it might be, athletic, you know, strength, intellect, whatever it might be, you don't spend a lot of time praying about that. Why? Because you feel confident that you can handle anything in that arena. It's one of the reasons why God, I think, chooses people who are not confident like Moses.
I was the same. I hated getting up in front of people. I was a salesman for years, but I was drunk all the time. I mean, I drank constantly. Why? Because I was insecure, because I wasn't comfortable in front of other people. But I had to be there in order to make a buck. I was like the guy, literally, I've said it before, but I was really like the guy that nobody knew I drank until they saw me sober. Because I always had a buzz going. I always had a little bit of a high to take the edge off, quote unquote. Because it was hard for me to deal with people. So when I got saved and I told the Lord, I'll do whatever you want me to do, and they started asking me to do different things, I was freaking out. I got to tell you, I was praying all the time simply because I thought I'd just make such a fool out of myself. Because I didn't like getting up in front of people. It made me trust God. And it's true to this day. I never get up here feeling like, I got this. You know, I can handle this. I'm praying all the time. We're worshiping before the service. Saturday nights, I don't sleep much. I'm waking up almost all the time. I start praying in tongues. I'm nervous about it, you know. But once I get here and start trusting the Lord, it all just kind of goes away. Lord. Now, I may think about it after I get home and think, oh, what an idiot. Why'd you say that? You shouldn't have said this. You know, I get critiquing everything. But I'm just saying, God gives us grace to do the things that we depend on Him for.
Thank you, Lord.
If it was just me being able to do it, it would be my flesh, and it wouldn't amount to anything. Praise the Lord. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. So the key there is, don't worry. Be happy. Praise the Lord. Don't worry. Be happy. Honestly. I mean, it's so simple, but it's true. All right, a couple more scriptures and we'll quit here. Luke chapter 9, verse 10 and 11. And the apostles, when they were returned, told him all that they had done, and he took them and went aside privately into a desert place belonging to the city called Bethsaida. Now, he didn't take them to Bethsaida. He took them to a desert place that was near Bethsaida, right? And the people, when they knew it, followed him, and he received them and spake unto them of the kingdom of God and healed them that had need of healing. Amen? Now, here's what's interesting. Bethsaida, however you want to pronounce it, is that word, it's a Hebrew word. Beth always means house or home of, right? Beth El, Beth Lahem. You know, Beth is designated as a town or a community, right? And Saida comes from a root Hebrew word, which is Sayad. And it's, I'll let you look it up for yourself. The root word is 6719 in the Hebrew concordance. And it means house of hunt.
Wow.
House of hunt. So here you have these people, and he takes them out to this desert place nearby, not into Bethsaida, but nearby. Why? Because these people are, by definition, hunting for healing.
Yes.
They're hunting for deliverance. They're hunting for restoration. They are self-efforting, in other words, to get this.
Wow.
They're trying to make it happen. They're trying to find it. They're trying to produce it, right? By performance. All right, let me show you again. Mark chapter 8, verses 22 and 23. This will be the last scripture. Mark 8, 22 and 23. So he comes again to the house of hunt, Bethsaida, and they bring him a blind man unto him and besought him to touch him. The blind man came and said, please, touch me, heal me. And what did he do? He took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the town. And when he had spit on his eyes and put his hands upon him, he asked him if he saw aught. And of course, you know the story. First he says, I see men as trees. He prays again, and immediately he says he sees men. He sees perfectly, right?
Right.
But what's interesting is he takes him away from this place where it's all about what you can produce.
Mm-hmm.
He could have just healed him right there. He could have done it right then, but he didn't. He takes him out of this house of hunt, out of this self-effort, out of this what you can find and produce and get. He takes him away from there in order to heal him.
Uh-huh.
Why? So that the guy knows it isn't anything you've done. You can't do this. I'm going to do it. God is going to make this happen. The Spirit is going to produce this. Not you. Not your effort. Not your pleading. Not your begging. Not your please help me out. No. Just the Spirit of God. Amen?
Amen?
He took them to a place of rest. A place where they could rest from the hunt. Relax. Rest. In Him.
Amen.
He can do all things through Christ who strengthens you.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Who heals you. Who prospers you. Who blesses you. Who saves you. Amen.
Amen.
Nothing is impossible with Him.
Right.
Most things are at least very difficult for us. If not impossible.
Thank you, Lord.
He's saying, come away from the hunt. Relax. Rest. And watch what I can do.
Amen.
To God be the glory.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Give Him a hand clap. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. God bless you. You are dismissed in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
Go in the Spirit. Praise the Lord.
Amen.